Welcome to Libertarian Counterpoint. I am Lee Welter, Secretary of the Libertarian Party of Sacramento, hosting our panel today. With me are Ryan Herche, a candidate for Natomas School Board, that's a neighborhood in the Sacramento metropolitan area, and Mike Giles, who is a teacher with some, I hope you're not insulted, libertarian thinking about some of these vital societal problems.
Sure.
Ryan, how did you get interested in running for the school board? It sounds like a challenge to me, and certainly a very vital function, but it takes a lot of dedication, a lot of know-how. How did this come about?
You know, the journey really started with my parents. My parents taught me about the importance of education. They taught me about the importance of being involved in the political process. And as I grew up, I remember we used to sit around the dinner table. I have four younger brothers. And my parents talked to us about politics. They talked to us about world events. And I learned the importance of being engaged civically and being involved in our local politics. Because I do subscribe to the maxim that all politics is local. And I think, therefore, it's crucial that we be involved as citizens to exercise our freedom to be involved in that process and to make our voices heard. So my core value as a candidate is to promote equal and quality access to education. And I'm confident that as we proceed in our discussion tonight, we'll be able to explore certainly some aspects of that and how we can make sure that we promote access to education.
That's wonderful to hear. I'm sure you realize that you might be considered a threat to the status quo and those who benefit from the status quo. So one of our jobs this evening is to let you express yourself and let the voters realize that they do have a better choice.
Yeah. Oh.
And Mike, you work as a teacher.
Yes. There's so many fantastic things going on out there, admixed with those things which maybe aren't so much fantastic as far as educating the kids in various ways. But one of the things that crossed my mind as I look around, and I'm always bringing things in, is a performing arts school that's out there in the Natomas area that I saw some fantastic musicians from.
Right.
Can you elaborate at all?
Sure. Natomas Charter School, it's a nationally acclaimed school. It specializes in the performing arts. And the school is home to the Benvenuti Performing Arts Center, where you have students performing at a very high level, at the high school level, but they're performing dance, musical productions, theatrical productions. It's really a tremendously inspiring scene to see these students gathered around. And they're able to do so because of the unique structure of that particular school. Natomas Charter School enables its teachers and its students to pursue a non-traditional course and curriculum that enables them to be truly successful in this area. It's a real asset to our district, and I think it's an inspiration for us going forward.
That's really exciting.
Yeah, well, one of the things that excites me about that is I've, for many years, I've noticed that there might be a tremendously talented ceramics student or drama student or musician, and come to find out, those are the classes, that the only classes that really bring the kids in. You know, they're not interested in, I mean, they'll function at a very minimal level maybe, or interest-wise, of math or something like that. But these other things are a really good auto shop program where people are really creating and learning. And so that's the inspirational part of the school systems, I think.
Yeah. Well, and Mike, that's something that excites me too, is taking advantage of local resources in Natomas. We're home to Universal Technical Institute, which trains students in auto shop. It gives them tangible real-world skills where they can go out and get a job and they can support themselves, support a family. And so I think it's really exciting that we have these kinds of local resources. What we ought to do is be connecting our schools to these resources. I think vocational training is a tremendous opportunity for those students, and that's definitely something I would seek to expand if I were elected to the school board.
Yeah, it's kind of music to my ears, the things you're saying, because I remember a few decades ago, a kid who was a great auto mechanic in high school, 4 years out of high school, he could be having a very good job, buying a house, starting a family, whereas now that's not the case.
Small business is being squashed, especially in California. It's unfortunate. That's not going to be the focus of our discussion. But you had a nice talk with Mark Montgomery not too long ago.
I did.
Small Biz Talk Radio.
That's right. Good. We kicked off our campaign on June 30th, and we're very excited, getting a lot of great response. When I ran in 2010, I knocked on over 6,000 doors. So it was a really phenomenal opportunity to realize the community is this big, you know, and most of us only get the opportunity to meet just a dozen people who live on our street. So it's been very satisfying for me, and I've learned a lot that I never would have learned about the district had I not knocked on those doors and heard about parents talking about their kids being overloaded with homework and parents who weren't familiar with their kids' grades and didn't know how to talk to their teachers and didn't understand the course requirements and wanted to see more opportunities in sports. And there were various forms of feedback that I received, so I highly recommend it, and I wish that more candidates for political office would really take the time to talk to voters in that door-to-door setting.
I could add that I had a little chat with Ryan at a mixer sponsored by Students First. I've been interested in their organization and also have attended several meetings, most at the Guild Theater, held by Stand Up Sacramento, particularly focused on improving literacy and reading skills in elementary school children. My recollection, Ryan, is you mentioned an interest in rhetoric, speech, and debate. Is that correct?
That's absolutely right.
Once Ryan said that, and I heard him talking to Mark Montgomery, I decided he had to join us on Libertarian Counterpoint. Among other reasons, somebody who is skilled in debate will not focus like a laser on their own narrow viewpoint. And I confess, I get pretty narrow sometimes, and well, maybe you do too, Mike.
Occasionally.
But if you can broaden your scope, try to understand the viewpoint in what your opponent is trying to express, you can be more effective. You can win the debate and maybe even win over some converts in the process.
Yeah, I've had the privilege to be a high school speech and debate coach for a few years, and that's been a tremendously satisfying experience because as you equip students to be confident enough to express themselves verbally, they develop an executive skill that serves them when they're applying for jobs. The ability to organize thoughts into words and be able to express it in a way that's compelling to people makes a huge difference when you're out applying for jobs. And it also enables the students, I think, to more critically self-examine as well. Because if you are forced to explain your beliefs about fundamental life questions, right? Like, what is the purpose of life? What do I want to accomplish? What is the difference between right and wrong? Big picture philosophical questions. If you're not able to clearly explain your positions on those issues, I think it causes students to begin to go through that journey of self-exploration and questioning to begin to try to find some solid answers. And I don't want to knock on the table, but, you know, we're looking for something firm, right? Mm-hmm. Something that's not going to give. Right? Something solid like my head, right? So that's, you know, that's been a really satisfying element of that experience.
Yes, well, I'm just really refreshed by what I'm hearing tonight from both you gentlemen, because the dynamic that's in the schools is not something that can be prescribed by those who are running the system. You know, the kids are there. They come from so many different places. I'll just use that word. And each kid is so important. Every kid is important. And to serve the best overall interest it's almost like a magical mix that has to be kind of worked out in each class. But those people, such as yourself, both you gentlemen, show signs of being those persons so strongly, and I'm just very feeling good about it.
That's great.
I did have a list of topics. We can address them in turn, but I don't want to let that distract us from the more important path that we might follow in the course of our show tonight. One I spotted in the news recently was a headline, Boehner and Lieberman once again save the DC Opportunity Scholarship Program, otherwise known as the DC Public Schools Voucher System.
Oh, the voucher system.
The Obama administration, having already tried to abolish this program, is still limiting the increase in vouchers to about 6%, I have read. What motivates their opposition, Mike?
Well,
be kind now.
I'll try.
He is our president.
It's not him most particularly. The my former party is very, very ingrained in with the teachers' unions, education
teachers' union,
and they would be adversely affected economically if more and more kids leave their little system that's under their control and goes over to vouchers or private schools or charter schools or religious schools or any
okay.
other kind of a school.
Yeah, we've seen efforts to do this, and they're making limited progress. And Ryan, if every family had school choice, would that mean we'd need fewer teachers? Would the teachers still be teaching somewhere?
Well, there's always going to be demand for teachers.
Yes.
Absolutely.
But maybe not the demand for the union that we currently have.
Well, right, because the unions are tied to the status quo, and they are an integral part of the structure of that system. And the nature of the status quo, the nature of any vested interest, is to seek its own self-preservation.
Sure.
Can't blame it for that.
It's no surprise, you know, I think, to see this kind of a response. And I think that as policymakers and as people who are education advocates, I think that we as Americans ought to promote access to education, and that ought to be our messaging, that the purpose of the DC voucher program was to expand access to education for low-income families. And that message I cannot hammer home enough. I mean, in Natomas, for example, at Natomas High School, 77% of the students enrolled in that high school qualify for free and reduced lunch. There are a tremendous number of low-income households. And so the question is, okay, how are we meeting the needs of those students, right? Because those students are going to graduate. They're going to spend a few years in school, and then they're going to leave, and they're going to go on, and they're going to try to find jobs or try to go to college. We have to realize that a single mother, you know, who's trying to hang on to maybe a part-time job, maybe she's reliant on welfare, she's trying to feed her family, maybe she's living with her parents, whatever the case may be, she doesn't have the luxury to move her children to another district or to put them on a bus and send them to a better school or to stay at home full time and be a homeschool mother. Or she doesn't have the flexibility to pay tuition to put them into private school.
Yes, that's the catch. In fact, that
Absolutely.
Explains something very well, that of the 545 powerful politicians in Washington, D.C., somebody said that fewer than a handful, and that leaves some extra fingers, have chosen to send their children to the public school system in Washington, D.C. Can you remember when this very prominent family was moving from Chicago to Washington, D.C.? Where will they send their two daughters? Public schools? Sidwell Friends. Same place the Clintons sent their daughter.
I see.
Because they can afford to do it.
A very well-schooled, elitist place.
well, good school, without a doubt.
Very, very good school.
Can't fault them for that.
I really don't know what to say. You know, it's just so.
But in essence, the
it's
people,
so what it is.
The folks that are sending their children to what's called private schools, I like to call them independent community schools, are the ones that can afford to pay twice. They pay for the public school system, and they put out some tuition for this special school that they've chosen for their children. a large number of public school teachers send their children to a Catholic school or another private independent institution.
Yeah, so all those people, all the people that send their kids to Catholic schools or any other kind of schools, even the homeschooling situations, they are all paying twice.
Yes.
And
but there's an irony to that. And I did a little extra reading that you may or may not have gotten to. The report that I saw about the DC voucher program was that those fortunate families and the children that got benefit of the vouchers no longer suffered from the miserable 56% graduation rate of the public school students. The graduation rate rose into the 90s, somewhere between 91 and 95%, which is a very dramatic improvement. The complaint is, this is taking away money from our public schools. But unless somebody can demonstrate that I'm wrong or that I misread something, the cost per public school system per year in the Washington, D.C. system is $26,600.
Per student per year.
And the cost of a voucher for one student for the year was $6,600. $20,000 less. $20,000 savings for every voucher student. Well, how can you pass that up? Well, you have to feel sorry for those politicians who are beholden to the unions because they're stuck in a bind. They don't want our kids to suffer. I'm sure they don't, but they don't want their election chances to be suffer either.
They don't care enough to
bind. It surely is.
And this truly goes back to the issue of local control, because at each additional layer of government, imagine a stack of pancakes, right? If you stack on more pancakes and you start pouring maple syrup on top of that stack, there's going to be less and less maple syrup that makes it to the bottom pancake, right? And similarly, we have this incredibly layered education system nationwide where the federal government takes a piece, then the state takes a piece, then we have the county, some is apportioned to cities, and we have a patchwork of local school districts. At each level, resources are removed from the system, such that the Legislative Analyst's Office in 2005 for the state of California reported that our per pupil funding per year is in the neighborhood of $11,600 per student. But in Natomas Unified, only about $6,600 is available per pupil. That's still a substantial sum of money, but it represents a substantial reduction in funding that was drained at the upper levels. That has got to stop. We have got to turn that around, because the erosion of local control is affecting our students, and it's artificially inflating this crisis in education funding, which our politicians so consistently bemoan.
This brings to mind an anecdote that I read of an investigative journalist who noted that the New York City public school system has an administration building housing somewhere over 2,000 employees. I forget if the number's closer to 2,200 or 2,600, well over 2,000. That investigative journalist, clever gal or fellow, whoever, realized that the Catholic Archdiocese of New York has schools enrolling approximately a fifth or 20% of the number in the public school system. He found out where their headquarters was. He called and asked, "How many employees do you have devoted to the Catholic public or the Catholic private schools in New York City?" The woman who answered the phone said, "I don't know. Nobody's asked us that question before, but hold on just a moment." She says, "I'll find out and I'll let you know." He waited. She came back. She said, "There are 27 of us."
Wow.
Huge difference. Tells us something, doesn't it?
Right.
And clearly, those Catholic schools each have a lot of local autonomy and local control. Not lacking guidance from the administration, but not being micro-controlled either.
Well, yeah, I mean, I've noticed, and anybody who's paying any kind of attention notices that the even as a lot of our schools are kind of like challenged as far as numbers of students. They're kind of like maybe dropping in numbers.
Some of them are.
But the administration monies and offices keep growing, and they outgrow the original building. Then they have other satellite buildings that fill up with all these administrative officials. It's an easy trap. It kind of happens.
What do you think of that, Ryan?
Yeah, it's a problem. I mean, the bloating, the top heaviness, the administrative overreach, it's a problem at every level. And so I think that the more local the control, the better, right? State is better than federal. County better than state. And ultimately, the local school district is an even better locus. But I think when we go back to who's our market, who are we serving? We've got to serve kids. We have to educate children. And the low-income mother who is struggling to put her kids through school, who has no choice but to put her kids in the local school down the street, who can't afford to put them in a better school, who can't afford to move to another district, we have got to meet that mother's needs. And I think that means ultimately that that mother, that parent, ought to have a measure of financial stake in the how her tax dollars are spent. She ought to have a measure of control, because who's going to make the best decision for that child?
The family, of course.
Absolutely.
The parents are rational people. They're going to put their kids in the best possible place they can find. Providing those parents with choices is always a good idea, and it's always going to lead to better outcomes for those students. We have to stand up for those kids, because those are the kids who don't have options, and those are the kids who are being failed every single day in the current system.
Absolutely. I mean, I was like toward the bottom here, it mentions Waiting for Superman, and I was privileged to be at a very big meeting. Bill Bennett and other people came, and KJ, Mr. Johnson's, this thing he's done over what used to be called Sacramento High School, it's absolutely astounding. I remember it when it was failing 40% of its students, and I worked there under the greatly privileged chance to work with fine teachers amidst all that stuff. But what's happening now is I think the graduation rate is in the 97% to 98%.
And the college enrollment is way up.
Yeah, and it's a charter school system that the parents are involved with. I mean, there's just a huge... I mean, I heard the kids talking from the student government. They were just fantastic, totally articulate, dynamite, just students, just makes you proud, you know. And it's nothing like the old Sacramento High School used to be.
Even more exciting from my perspective is what's called PS7, Public School Number 7, which is in a relatively impoverished neighborhood, which was, in essence, a failing school until it was operated by St. Hope Academy, Kevin Johnson's organization.
Oh, okay.
It is now one of the top performing elementary schools.
Wow, that's
doing
great.
Very well. And I know somebody who worked for an educational consultancy who had tears in her eyes when she talked about her personal experience seeing how that school was conducted and run, and then later seeing the very, not the identical individuals, but the very same population of students with a very different attitude and higher level of skills. It's very, very impressive. For those of you who want to learn more about this topic, this is an excellent, I don't know if somebody can zoom in on this, there we go, maybe camera three. We'll let Tony make the decision here. I read this book, which was published 15 years ago, completing my reading and thinking, this is an idea, a crusade that was slightly ahead of its time. Both Alan Bonsteel and Carlos Bonilla are MDs, they are physicians. That's why they call it, I presume, curing the crisis in America's schools. They have a prescription. We will be talking about that to some extent later. So there it is. It's available at the Sacramento Public Library, and I recommend it strongly. In the few minutes we have left, I spotted a headline. California Teachers Association's, quote, the Education Coalition makes a claim or a plea, quote, public schools, an investment we can't afford to cut. What do they really mean by that, Ryan?
Well, you know, it's hard to know exactly the intent of that particular author, but a common concern raised by many public commentators, many journalists, and certainly the California Teachers Association has been that we ought not to cut education funding because funding is directly proportional to student achievement. And so that, I think, is a central claim that is being put forward. My concern is not so much the level of funding, but how we're currently allocating our dollars, because we have so little control over how we actually spend our education dollars at this point. We have an absolutely dire crisis. And what's sad to see is education used as a political football, where we have the governor's proposed trigger cuts. 99% of those trigger cuts hit education. And the governor has structured this in such a way that it sort of pressures voters to raise taxes.
Yeah.
But I think that regular voters in the public, I think people are concerned that the money's not really reaching the school system. And worse, that it's not reaching the kids in the classroom, and it's not making a difference for the child of that low-income single mom who is struggling to make ends meet. The money's not making it. And no matter how much syrup we dump on that stack of pancakes, you know, how do we actually get the dollars into the classroom where it makes a difference? Local control, school choice, empowering parents to be able to choose their school, empowering parents to have control over their child's education future and over their child's tax dollars. That is absolutely vital, and it's an important step in the direction of reform. And I'll give you an example in my district, the Natoma School District. We have a school called Jefferson Elementary, which is now in year 3 of program improvement. In plain English, that means if the school goes for another 2 years, in other words, gets to year 5 without effectively bringing up its test scores, then the school will be either slated for closure, a state or federal takeover. They'll have to either fire the principal and most of the teachers and start over, or they have the option to convert that school into a charter school. A majority of the parents at that school are low income. This is a justice issue for those families. Absolutely vital that we get those students into a place where they can learn, that we reform the structure of that school so that they can learn. Let's give them some choices. That's what I'd say. Let's look at some options. Let's not wait for those 2 years to run out and for those kids to be shuffled along to higher grades with insufficient preparation.
Yes. I'm with you 100% on that. And as we're winding down here, I'll remind folks that you can watch this on a number of different cable channels, Comcast, Cable 17 in Sacramento.